lawyer sought information for a living. That is to say that ever since he returned from Korea, after having served with the armed forces, he had been working as a private investigator in Montreal. William Hamilton, a rich industrialist, had gotten in touch with him regarding a simple vandalism issue. Nothing to write home about. Not worth hiring a private eye either, just so he can drive for hours on rough roads. But that's how it had always been. The client pays, Carl gets it done. Always comes a time when it's just too late to change your mind. His meeting was right around the corner. Wasn't a good time to wander about. Hamilton was still out there. They had set up to meet at the general store, his client's business. Well, actually, the entire village had William Hamilton's name written all over it. Or snowed in, it was customary around these parts to close them off. But it was also customary to ignore those signs entirely and drive there anyway. Diligent in his work, always carried his log on him, in which he scribbled down thoughts and leads alike during the course of his investigations. Hamilton never mentioned a roadblocking barrier. Why was it needed here in the back of beyond? That would, however, be a mystery for another day. Carl had waited long enough for someone to come and raise it. Still not a soul in sight. There was no point in waiting any longer. Carl had to figure this one out by himself. Hamilton is waiting for Carl in the general store. It was time for him to get down to business. Carl was meeting his client in a store near this area. He was on the right track. Enjoyed a lavish country house built in the very heart of the northern forests, not too far from here. To further his fortunes, and those ones hated him enough to go on about scheming against him. Hamilton had recently acquired a few local businesses, but the last straw was the reopening of a mine, which gave rise to a wave of protests and threats from the Cree people. Given these circumstances, Carl reckoned that a good number of people must be feeling compelled to oppose Hamilton in one way or another. So far, only the industrialist's house had been a target, but soon enough, Carl thought, the target would become the man himself. Carl was dying to stretch his legs, but he had to stay focused on the task at hand. Now wasn't a good time to wander about. Hamilton was still out there. Carl needed to get out of there. The cold and the pain required urgent care. The driver had taken off. It was still best to check it out and leave nothing to chance. Carl needed help. It was a small, locked box engraved with the letters WH. Carl thought about taking it. Nothing was to be left to chance. Thank you. Such heart-wrenching Nordic poetry, that was. But Carl didn't care much about flowery language. Scratches did not stop Carl. His mother would be so proud. This deep in the country, his last hope was to find an abandoned garage or a farm by the roadside. His life depended on it. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. The cold was burning Carl. He would not hold up much longer. He had to warm himself. Even better than he had hoped, Carl Faubert had succeeded once more and was now on his way to new adventures. A fire can't be started with a snap of the fingers. spread out on a few acres of untouched forest, bellowing caribou, everlasting snow, and undefiled lakes. The Manistan region was no tourist hub. It was said to have been populated for millennia by Cree people, and ever since the industrial era, by the metal mining industry. Carl's military training had made him a very punctual man. Being late to his meeting with Hamilton was out of... the question. Dying to stretch his legs, but he had to stay focused on the task at hand. Military training had made him a very punctual man. Being late to his meeting with Hamilton was out of the question. The truck was running on fumes. Good thing that the general store was close by. The store and its surroundings still held their secrets, and he didn't like to miss out. That had to be the worst parking job ever. Who was Carl to judge, though? It may be customary to park like that around these parts, or not. The punishing cold rendered the door frozen tight. Carl saw no way to open it. Was used to strange phenomena, but a chunk of ice like this, as if an iceberg came out of the ground, that was a first. Prince? Carl found a surprise at every turn. Was the camera faulty, or was there a possible lead? Polaroid, Carl's long-standing and faithful ally, had seen a share of husbands caught red-handed cheating. There's always something out there waiting to be snapped away. Carl wondered what the hell could that thing be. It looked like a man fossilized in ice. All of a sudden, Carl felt like he was pulled inside a world of dreams, a cold, unknown dimension. Somehow, Self-control was slipping from his grasp. To all appearances, this was a hunting log. Better yet, a war diary. What could these engraved numbers mean? A fresh path suddenly appeared before Carl. That feeling you get when you immerse your frozen hands in hot water. What happened? Now at least he knew who the unfortunate man petrified in ice was. Gilles Lachance, the general store's manager himself. It was so cold, already Carl did not feel his toes anymore. Maintaining his composure, Carl recalled something from his military training. Wolves always stay away from populated areas. Wait, was it about bears? Hate was in the air. Seems like some villagers barely tolerated each other. The cold was burning Carl. He would not hold up much longer. He had to warm himself. Something fell to the bottom of the box. Carl had no trouble recognizing his employer. He had been killed. There was no need to be a detective to figure that out. But only a detective could have noticed that the killer had to have been very close, that the fatal blow had been given before the victim even realized. Thank you. an explosion suddenly occurred outside. Carl knew that Gilles Lachance was in charge of the general store. That made him one of Hamilton's employees. A very angry employee, as Carl could plainly see. According to that log, it seemed like the whole village owed some money to the general store. Carl was far more interested in the bunch of nearby addresses he had just gotten his hands on, though. The snowstorm pummeled everything in its path. Carl was not surprised when he heard no tone. A radiator without power is as good as a wood stove without logs. The murder weapon. What was that doing there, Carl wondered. Hamilton must have been determined to keep some information secret to post this key. Shame he got unlucky. Everything made sense now. Poor Hamilton's denunciation was interrupted. And he figured it would be best to lock everything up and send the key to his correspondent, who would receive the box later on. Clever, but not enough. That's what happens to ordinary people playing spy. A milkman had to drive by every week to fill the bottles. The fresh milk indicated a recent visit. The note explained that the garage and the store couldn't be supplied with electricity at the same time. What could be inside that envelope? Carl was taken aback. He knew this address. It was said to be the address of the P.O. box for the Canadian Secret Service. the crowbar was stuck under the lift. Notwithstanding Carl's imposing stature, car lifting wasn't part of his skill set yet. At long last, the crowbar was within Carl's grasp. Surely it would come in handy at some point. Jumping from that height was akin to tempting death. Perhaps that man on the snowmobile had seen enough of this world already. A nice picture of the Magasin La Chance store, seemingly taken the day it was first opened. It feels frozen in time, from an era long forgotten. Amateur hunters showing some pride at having killed a nice pelted beast. With men like this roaming the area, wolves would become extinct within 10 years, Carl thought.
Thank you.
Carl, like many of his contemporaries, felt like he had more trouble breathing when he wasn't smoking. Cigarette was his own personal breathing assistant. Carl felt that the store and its surroundings still held their secrets, and he didn't like to miss out.
Thank you.
Carl knew straight away where to find the infuriated Gilles Lachance. Any good investigation would have to start there. Felt that the store and its surroundings still held their secrets, and he didn't like to miss out. The crossbow bolt stuck into the wooden stairs reminded Carl of the arrow that was said to have hit Achilles' heel. But who was the intended Achilles this time? The air was freezing right down to the bone. Looks like the holes in that puzzle are there to stay. The pot was cold, and the stew inside wasn't cooked. It's likely that poor Giselle was slow cooking it before she got snapped. What a waste. Moving. What a pleasant activity. Of course, you'll find the record player only to find the records weeks later in some random box. The general store, along with several more infrastructures in the area, had been acquired by wealthy industrialist William J. Hamilton. Perhaps the village should be rechristened Hamiltown. What a mess. Clearly, there was some major revamping work underway here. The place looked barely habitable. A nice white coating would restore the room to its charm of olden days. Many boxes scattered about. Carl didn't need to summon his detective training to quickly figure that the LaChausses had just moved in. A nice white coating would restore the room to its charm of olden days. Many boxes scattered about. Carl didn't need to summon his detective training to quickly figure that the LaChausses had just moved in. A nice white coating would restore the room to its charm of olden days. Beautiful portrait of Gilles and Giselle, bound together by the chains of conventional love. The cross looked after a marriage's well-being, and served as a motivator to uphold the priest's sermons calling for more little worshipers on one hand, and cautioning against guilty pleasures on the other. Indeed, the LaChances were still part of the God-fearing generation. The otherworldly ice had struck again. The woman's hopes and dreams were frozen in eternity. Something was hidden under the stairs. The man grabbed his rifle. Carl felt a sense of dread in him. Perhaps their spousal relationship had been cooling down lately. It seemed like secrecy was commonplace in this house. The vision's veil was lifted, and he was back to reality. A reality in which Giselle, Jill's loving spouse, was motionless, frozen in ice. Moving. What a pleasant activity. Of course, you'll find the record player only to find the records weeks later in some random box. Carl had seen that kind of safe before, with its double-layered security system blending letters and numbers. Its code couldn't be broken by the common burglar. Thank you. true Catholic always strives to keep lowly temptations at bay. Obviously, Carl thought, someone in this house wasn't doing a good job at upholding the Holy Bible's teachings. Carl smiled at the sight of the nicely protected garden. Hopefully, the Bedards had managed to dig every last potato out before the sudden snowfall. Carl was no burglar. He didn't need to resort to petty techniques such as window breaking to find his way in. A good detective simply looks for keys where gullible souls hide them. What was even the point of locking your door if everyone hid their key in the same place? Carl was starting to feel like his investigator life lacked challenge. The house smelt like incense, the kind that reminds you of the good Lord, of peace. Religion was very influential throughout Quebec many years ago. Indeed, it was surprising that Carl did not come across a single chapel since arriving here. Good Paul VI, appearing papal. His crooked fingers gave the impression he was about to bestow a miracle. The perfect cookie-cutter Catholic family, most likely attending church every Sunday. Who knew that giraffes thrived in the North Pole? The craze for toys was stupefying. Love of religion and ancestors was rooted deep inside the hearts of Canadians of old, to which the Bedards appeared to be closely related. The family's mother must have spent her days washing the filth off her kids' diapers. The empty cradle sent an eerie feeling down Carl's spine, as if minutes ago someone just grabbed the baby and made a run for it. Jean-Luc Bedard had without a doubt been the closest man in the village to William Hamilton, otherwise known as Uncle Willie. The Bedards had vacated the premises. Carl gathered they would be of no help. Dream catchers originated from First Nations legends. They were used to trap nightmares. It was a classic Canadian house, except for the absent horde of kids that would normally be swarming about. Just one more move and White is checkmated. Game over. It seems the game was abandoned right before the final strike came down. Simone de Beauvoir, Claude Lévi-Strauss, Hannah Arendt, Roland Barthes. Carl was surprised by the literature filling this liberal-leaning bookcase. Could there really be intellectuals dwelling in this far-off land? The couple radiated something akin to lightheartedness, to freedom. Perhaps some people out there truly found a way to live happily ever after. The photograph was snapped not too far from here, Carl noticed. The couple seemed to be very good friends. A picture of Wilfred in his youth. Carl figured right away that the man must have been some kind of wildlife officer. Not a single weapon was left. All of them were gone. All manners of clothing were gone, as if the Rois drove out of town with their closet in tow. A steak alone cannot subdue a starving stomach. An appetite comes with eating. An axe, not too shabby. Carl felt he needed to protect himself. More materials were needed to stir up the flames. Thank you.
Thank you.